A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Viewers, among all the things Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Messenger of Allah, had warned his sahabis or companions about, the coming of the Dajjal is the most significant of all. He has asserted the Dajjal to be the single gravest event in the entire history of mankind, and himself has sought refuge with Allah from its fitna, its malice. Because of its influence, the entire mankind is to be led astray while rejecting the Almighty's directives, His sovereignty. Therefore, there is no scope to take the matter of the Dajjal lightly. The Messenger of Allah has described the Dajjal in allegorical terms as a great one-eyed giant, and we have taken the references so literally that we all await a giant of such huge proportions. Moreover, we fail to realize that it has come into being 473 years back and has passed its childhood, youth, and is now in the stage of a mature adult. But due to our narrow vision, we are yet to recognize it. Today, the whole world, along with the huge population of so-called Muslims, have accepted the Dajjal as their Rabb, meaning sustainer, and are busy prostrating themselves before its superior power. The truth is, the Judeo-Christian materialistic civilization is in fact the one-eyed giant, which this documentary will prove, inshallah. There are some basic concepts we need to be clear about. So let us start with the creation of man.
Allah wished to create a being endowed with all His attributes, His sifats, along with His free will. Free will power from Him. Therefore, this creature would have the power to choose whether to obey Him or make up ways of life, rules, regulations themselves. When He revealed of His intention to create man to the malaiks, the angels, they replied, "Will thou place therein one who will do harm and shed blood?" Allah disregarded their opinion and went on to create Adam. However, this being was not created with the command of Be, but with His own hands, and then was breathed into from His soul. As a result, this new creature, Adam, rose to the highest position among all creation, bearer of all attributes and sifats of Allah Himself. When Allah commanded His malaiks to sajda, prostrate themselves before Adam, they all obeyed except Iblis, whose pride refrained him from doing so. For this act of disobedience, Allah cursed him, now and forever to be known as the Ar-Rajim. Iblis, on the other hand, challenged Allah, saying, "Now, because thou hast sent me astray, verily, I shall lurk in ambush on the right path. Then I shall come upon them from before them, from behind them, and from their right hands, and from their left hands, and you will not find most of them beholden unto thee." To this Allah declared, "Go down, all of you, from here, but surely there come to you from me a guidance. Whoso follows my guidance, there shall no fear come upon them, neither shall they grieve." Allah accepted Iblis's challenge, for the purpose of His creation of man was to put him to test. Thus began the journey of man, forever in trial to see what he followed, if he gave in to Iblis's whisperings or remained steadfast on the directives of Allah. However, Adam gave in to the lure of Iblis and disobeyed Allah. As a punishment for this, both Iblis and Adam were sent to this world and made enemies to each other.
Dear audience, the conversation between Allah and His malaiks give rise to some important questions, such as, Allah declared He created Adam as His representative or vicegerent. What does that stand for? How did the malaiks know in advance that they would create anarchy and shed blood on earth. What steps did Allah take to prevent this anarchy and bloodshed? What does Siratul Mustaqim or straight, simple path stand for? And lastly, what is the meaning of Allah? It is quite impossible to understand the concept of the Dajjal if the answers to these questions are not known. So let us try to clear the meaning of these questions first. This entire universe is governed by Allah Himself, in accordance to His will and rules. But in the case of man, He did not directly retain the reins of governance. Instead, He entrusted mankind to govern themselves in keeping with the ordinances sent by Him. When man leads his collective social life, his personal and political lives, in short, his entire life as ordered by the Almighty, it is then that man carries out his responsibility of being Allah's representative. That is his main primary duty for which he was created. To work as Allah's representative, surely man needed to be empowered accordingly. This Allah accomplished by breathing from his soul into Adam. Example, mankind. With Allah's soul came all his attributes and qualities, including his free will power. The malaiks were able to tell that with this free will power, man would be in a position to reject Allah's orders and create fasad and safakuddima, which means anarchy, disorder and bloodshed on earth. It is clear from Iblis's challenge that his main objective is to influence man, denounce Allah's order, and thus stray from the Siratul Mustaqim. The natural consequence of which would be turmoil, wars, and the shedding of blood. To prevent this, the Almighty revealed a complete code of life, which He named Dinul Islam, or the way of life of peace. The foundation of this system lay in Tawhid, La ilaha illallah, meaning there is none to be obeyed other than Allah. One who has the final authority or the last say in any matter, whether personal, social or matters of the state, is said to be the sovereign, the ilah. The role of the sovereign is highly important because no decision can be reached in any aspect of life, be it personal, social or national issue, without any one authority having the final say. So, the role of the sovereign is present in all constitutions, such as, in the case of monarchy, the sovereign is king or emperor. For democracy, it is the majority population. For socialism and communism, the sovereign is the elite ruling class. For fascism, it's the dictators. And finally, for Islam, the sovereign is the Almighty Allah. This proves that whichever system of life you may accept, you definitely have to adhere to a particular form of sovereignty, meaning there is no compromise regarding this issue. Similarly, since the sovereign of two systems are not the same, it is not possible to accept two ways of life at one time. Therefore, democracy and socialism can't be accepted at a time, just as Islam and monarchy or democracy can't be accepted at a parallel. For this Allah has most assuredly declared, "Inil hukmu illa lillah," meaning the decision rests with Allah only. Therefore, to accept Allah's sovereignty is to reject the word of any other in any aspect of life, where the word of Allah already exists. This is Siratul Mustaqim, the straight and simple path. Now let us see how Iblis influenced mankind to deviate from this Siratul Mustaqim and slither into the pitfalls of turmoil, unrest, injustice and bloodshed.
The first victory of Iblis came when he successfully influenced the son of Adam and Hawa, Qabil, to murder his brother Habil. The forewarning of the malaiks had come true. That was the beginning of fasad and safakuddimma, injustice, unrest and violence. The children of Adam and Hawa gradually spread all over the world, and in keeping with His word, Allah sent a long series of messengers to bring mankind to the guidance. Iblis has not been sitting idle either. He kept up his relentless pursuit of straying mankind from Hidayah and throwing them into unrest, turmoil and bloodshed. In this long sequence of messengers, Allah sent His distinguished messenger, Nuh, to bring mankind back to the folds of Hidayah. He preached among His people for over 900 years, but without any success. Iblis had blinded them to such an extent that they failed to respond to Nuh's call. In the end, Allah decided to punish them for this act of denial and ordered Nuh to build a ship which would carry his companions and a pair each of all the animals of the world. When all of Nuh's companions and animals were on board, Allah caused rains and floods of such proportions that they wiped off the existence of everything else. Only Nuh and his companions survived. When the rains and floods had ceased, Nuh and his companions descended at a mount named Judi. The children of Adam again started to spread all over the world. They implemented the sovereignty of Allah in all aspects of their lives and lived in peace and tranquility. With the passage of time, they brought variations to the laws of Nuh and gradually fell back to the age of problems of fasad and safakuddimma. Over the next thousands of years, Allah continued to send Nabis and messengers from Him to every civilization. The messenger Ibrahim was sent at a time when Namrud had rejected the sovereignty of Allah and declared himself Rabb. Ibrahim and his followers tried in vain to call Namrud and his people towards Tawheed. They rejected his call and threw Ibrahim into a blazing fire. But Allah, in His mercy, caused the fire to turn into a cooling breeze for Ibrahim. In his false pride and arrogance, Namrud threw an arrow at Allah. As punishment for his audacity and rejecting the call of Tawheed, Allah caused Namrud destroyed all told. After this, the Deen of Allah was established and Allah honored Ibrahim as a preferred messenger. Of the two sons of Ibrahim, Ismail settled in Makkah, while Isaac settled in Hebron, Palestine. The family of Isaac was blessed by a series of Nabis, among whom was Yaqub, also known as Israel. With the passage of time, however, the Bani Israelis deviated from Tawheed and as punishment were turned into the slaves of the Pharaohs. A long time later, the Almighty took pity on their enslavement and sent the messenger Musa, who urged the worshippers of Ra to accept the sovereignty of Allah, to accept La ilaha illallah, there is none to be obeyed other than Allah, but to no avail. At one point, Musa gathered the Bani Israelis and set out to free them from their captors. When they reached the shores of the Red Sea, Allah ordered Musa to strike the water with his staff. As he did so, the waves parted to make a dry way for them to walk over. When the Pharaoh and his army reached the shores in their pursuit, they saw Musa and his people crossing over. But no sooner had the Pharaoh with his army stepped into the walkway than the waves crashed in on them from both sides and drowned them. However, despite this major miracle, mu'jiza from Allah, and numerous other miracles, there was no lasting effect on the collective character of the Bani Israelis. Even while the messenger Musa was present among them, they took to worshipping of the calf. Time and again they continued to commit major transgression and cross the limits set by Allah. Allah continued to give them chances to rectify their ways through series of messengers. However, they refrained from mending their errors, and after Musa, there was not a single messenger from Allah that the Bani Israelis accepted universally. One after another, messenger from Allah gave up his life in their cruel hands. In this manner, the Bani Israelis were responsible for the deaths of countless Nabis and an unknown number of mu'min believers. Owing to the curse put on them by David or Dawud alayhi salam, the Bani Israelis were long since enslaved by pagan Romans when the last messenger among them, Isa alayhi salam, was sent. Although they still claimed to accept the laws of the Torah, the alims or learned elders of the faith had caused it to lose the balance with their excessive analysis of the practical side. It was to restore this balance between the spiritual and practical aspects of the faith that Allah sent Messenger Jesus or Isa, who first and foremost reiterated his faith in the laws, Sharia, brought by Musa. He reaffirmed that he had been sent for the wayward sheep of the Bani Israelis and forbid his disciples to preach to any persons of different faith. For this reason, the pagan rulers saw no threat to their position by his preaching. Instead, he incurred the wrath of the Jewish clergy, the rabbis, Pharisees, and the Sadducees, who had made their living from spelling religious decrees. They were the same clergy that had turned the holy temple, Baitul Muqaddas, into their business center. The messenger Isa sought to bring an end to their unscrupulous practice, to the profound control they yielded over the general mass, thus turned into a major thorn in their side. On one hand, they convinced the Roman rulers that Isa posed a great threat to their position, and on the other, they propagated among the people that he was a renegade and a magician. It was as if Lucifer, Iblis himself, was manifest among the so-called clergy. When Isa's close companion Judas Iscariot sold his master for a mere 30 coins, Allah caused Isa to be bodily removed from this earth, and the traitor Judas was made to look identical to him. As punishment for his hypocrisy, Judas was the one to meet his death on the cross. After Isa's departure, Palestine became a very dangerous place for his disciples, who then fled to nearby different areas. Sometime after this, an erstwhile Jew named Paul claimed to bring faith in Isa's teachings. However, in light of his consequent actions, the true motive for his conversion is put to doubt. The messenger Isa was only sent for the Bani Israelis, and as such, he forbade his disciples to even approach anyone outside their group. Yet, this was exactly what Paul started to do. He convinced the other disciples to follow him into bringing people of other faiths into a new religion they called Christianity. As it was very difficult and dangerous for them to preach this revised new version among the Bani Israelis in Palestine, Paul and his group then set out to convert people of different European areas to this faith. At that time, most of Europe were worshippers of different gods and goddesses and even natural elements. They realized this new faith was far better in comparison to their existing ideas, and gradually most of Europe, along with the elite ruling class, converted to the new religion called Christianity.
Dear friends, we hope that it is now clear before you how devil Iblis has lured mankind into straying from the Siratul Mustaqim, the Tawheed sent from Allah, and slithered into pits of injustice, inequality, repression, and turmoil in their social lives. They perverted faith to suit their ends. Allah, in His mercy, has sent long chains of messengers, Nabis and Rasuls, to retain mankind within the folds of Tawheed. Whenever a new messenger has arrived with clear-cut proof from Allah, it has always been the clergy type from among the followers of the existing faith that turned out as the severest opponents of the new messenger. In this way have emerged many new religions. However, the faith of Christianity did not occur following this pattern. It seems to have followed a carefully thought-out plan altogether. If anyone brings faith in a particular Nabi or Rasul, it would be logical to think that he would respect and abide by the limits or regulations set by that Nabi himself. But Paul did exactly the opposite of what Isa alayhi salam had preached and insisted upon, spreading the religion of Christianity among people outside the Bani Israelis. In course of time, it is this Pauline Christianity that gave birth to the hardcore materialistic society, which the Messenger of Allah has described as the Dajjal. The Messenger of Allah has placed immense importance on the gravity of the Dajjal. Therefore, to get a clear understanding of his mission and the stress he has imparted on this particular issue, let us try to gauge the situation of his time and the objectives of his arrival.
The progeny of Ismail alayhi salam, the son of Ibrahim alayhi salam, were the inhabitants of the city of Makkah in Arabia. Throughout a long history of thousands of years, the changes they brought in the Sharia of Ismail had left little in resemblance to the actual faith. The house of the one God, Kaaba, was humiliated with the presence of numerous idols of various gods and goddesses. Yet, they still claimed to be the followers of Ibrahim, said their prayers as taught by him, performed the Hajj, and observed Psalm. They called themselves Abdullah, or the servants of Allah. They invoked the blessings of Allah before starting anything new, and even circled the Kaaba chanting Labbaik, Allahumma Labbaik. Despite all this, in their collective social lives, they had forsaken the directives of the Almighty and governed their lives in accordance to the regulations and rules imposed by the ruling class, mainly the Quraysh. In this situation, the Almighty fulfilled His promise to the progeny of Ibrahim and sent the most revered of all messengers into the family of Ismail. As a young child, Rahmatan lil Alameen was raised in the wild beauty of the deserts. Till the proclamation of the message, Nabuwat, he enjoyed a most honored and enviable position among the Makkans as the As-Sadiq, the truthful one. Yet, everything changed for him when the duty of a messenger from Allah was laid on his shoulders. No sooner had he declared La ilaha illallah, there is none to be obeyed other than Allah, no claimant of sovereignty save him, than the Makkans turned their backs on him. The person who for 40 years had been known to them as Al-Amin became infamous as a magician, a renegade, a liar, a madman. People who called themselves to be the Millat Ibrahim, followers of the Hanafi faith, turned their wrath on the small number of Mu'mins who declared to preach Tawheed, sovereignty of the Maker. Yet, despite all their efforts and persecution, they could not deter the Messenger of Allah or his small band of followers from the path of Tawheed. After suffering 13 long years at the hands of tribal chieftains, the elite ruling class of Makkah and the clergy, the Messenger of Allah was ordered to migrate to the city of Medina. Where he was warmly welcomed by all and laid the foundation for the first Muslim state to be governed on the principles of Allah's sovereignty. In the next phase, he established the law of life based on Tawheed throughout the entire peninsula of Arabia, and this he accomplished through a series of armed battles and skirmishes. He had been sent with a mission to establish Dinul Haq on this entire world, to achieve which he created a nation of warriors, a fearless, undaunted, undefeatable group of people whose sole aim in life was to die in battle. After the departure of the Messenger of Allah, the responsibility of establishing Dinul Haq on this world came to his followers, his people, and they rose magnificently to the task. In less than half a century, they conquered and subsequently brought under the banner of Tawheed more than half the landmass of the world. The world saw an era of peace and tranquility it had never known before. This is the true history of mankind. The perpetual fight between right and wrong, the acceptance and rejection of Allah's sovereignty, His Tawheed, the eternal duel between man's soul, the amana from Allah, and the luring of Iblis, both as individual and as society. This is not only the past, this is the present, and undoubtedly the future holds the same. Without a moment's pause or break, an uninterrupted, unbreakable cycle.
Dear viewers, the ways of life that the Almighty revealed through His long line of messengers have always been balanced and coordinated. On one hand, it contained rules and regulations which people obeyed on personal level, and on the other, it had limits and laws governing the society and national interests. Therefore, the need to separate faith from the national life of a people never arose. From time immemorial, it is the clergy, the learned class, among a society that has corrupted the facets of the faith through unnecessary analysis and overdoing. The fine balance has been lost, and societies saw a rise of anarchy, injustice, and bloodshed. At this point, Allah again has sent a messenger from Him to restore equilibrium. Let's take the case of the Bani Israelis, for instance. It was when they had destroyed the soul of the Jewish faith that Allah revealed the messenger Isa alayhi salam to rectify the situation. He claimed, "I have not been sent to void the laws of Musa. Indeed, I bear witness to it and confirm the law of Taurat." As he was sent to restore the spirituality of the Judaic faith, the gospel Isa brought with him did not contain any Sharia or national law. It held the principles of personal enrichment through piety and charity. All this was restricted within and applicable only to people of the Judaic faith. However, after the ascent of Isa alayhi salam to heaven, Paul preached among people outside the boundary of the Judaic faith. The result was that the en masse converts to the new faith entered a system that was devoid of one and every national aspect. They failed to understand that a system of life minus the economy, social life, penal code, politics, and national government was not only improbable, it was dysfunctional, impossible. Yet, this was what they tried to do. Subsequently, in their utmost effort in establishing an imbalanced way of life over the whole of Europe, these new Christians gradually came to face an unending clash between this worldly life and the hereafter. This clash between the rulers and the church became so poignant that the life of the common man was seriously threatened. This led to the need of creating a system outside the direct intervention of the church. During the reign of Henry VIII in 1537, it was finally decided that the church and state would be officially separated. The laws that govern the social, economics, national, example, collective lives of people would be decided by the people themselves. The limitations of right and wrong, of moral and immoral, would henceforth be decided by man himself. The Lord Creator ceased to have any say over these matters anymore. For the first time in history, man as a collective entity opted to forego the word of the Maker and usurp sovereignty for himself. This gave rise to a soulless, godless, materialistic civilization that the Messenger of Allah allegorically described as the Dajjal. Let us catch a glimpse of the Dajjal's evolution through video footage.
The part of the world where Islam was established dwelled in peace and harmony, in direct contrast to the large piece of Europe outside the perimeter of this way of life. They tried in vain to consolidate the faith promulgated by Paul in their collective lives. The various European kings ruled over their lands under the direct guidance provided by the Pope and the interpretations handed out by the clergy. Blinded by their faith and dependence on this clergy, the kings and rulers were compelled to obey the directives these men of God handed out. Whenever the rulers tried to go against them, the Pope and the clergy would incite the general people in the name of God and force the kings to carry out their edicts. The famous astronomer Galileo Galilei was one of the many who was put to death under directives of the Christian clergy. The number of innocent women who burned at the stake on charges of witchcraft remain unknown. Medieval barbarism is a phrase that was coined to convey the horror of the persecution, torture, and superstition of Christian Europe. This infamous label was later imposed on the Muslim civilization by these very people. The history of Europe given here after the departure of Isa alayhi salam has been a long chain of events comprising of the dual role of kings and the clergy. Between the autocratic role of the rulers and the fatwa, edict dispensing clergy, the common man's life indeed was miserable. For hundreds of years, the conflict between the church and the man took a huge toll of lives, resulting in utter disgust of faith on the people's part. The history of this conflict is so long and horrifying that it is not possible to detail it all in this video. There reached a point where there were only two options open to the rulers of Greater Europe. One was to renounce the faith of Christianity altogether, or second, to banish it to the narrow sphere of personal life only, from where it could hold no control over the national, social, political, and economic lives of people. As it was not possible to make so many people renounce Christianity and revert to paganism, the latter was taken up for serious consideration. During the reign of Henry VIII of England, the final step was taken, and Christianity lost its hold over the entire lives of the Christian population, was banished to the realm of personal life only. Sovereignty was effectively usurped from the Maker and placed in the hands of man. The Dajjal was born.
Dear audience, since the Judeo-Christian civilization matches the description of the Dajjal, let us clear the concept of civilization as best as we can. The root word of civilization is civil, example, cordial, cultured, good. In other words, a system that is based on the ideas of goodness, righteousness, and lawfulness is a civilization. From the beginning of time, Allah Himself has provided mankind with these ideals. The criterion of right or wrong has been His through His Nabis and Rasuls. This system is known to us as religions. For example, the Islamic civilization, the foundation of which lies in the sovereignty of Allah Himself, La ilaha illallah, with which all authority on every aspect of human existence, of social, economic, political, and personal, rests with Allah. In short, in the Islamic civilization, all criterion of good and bad, lawful or unlawful, is decided by Allah. Man himself has no authority or right to comment. On the other hand, in case of the new civilization that came into being in Europe in 1537, it was man himself who was the authority of judging between right and wrong. In collective social lives of mankind, the power to judge between do's and don'ts lay with man. Here, the Creator no longer had any say. In short, man replaced Allah as the Ilah, the sovereign from that time onwards. This was the beginning of the Dajjal, which has now passed its infancy, childhood, and matured into an adult. After 473 years, its tyrannical rule has extended its tentacles all over the world today. In their ignorance, the whole of mankind, as well as the entire Muslim population, lay prostrate at its feet. The only way to determine if this technologically advanced civilization is indeed the Dajjal, described by the Messenger of Allah, or not, is to compare the hadith relating to it to the actual scenario of this civilization.
The Messenger of Allah has said, there will be no greater event from the creation of man to the last day than the Dajjal, to be regarded as the most important event in the history of mankind is surely no small thing. During this long stretch of time, mankind was all but wiped out by the deluge in Noah's time. In the Kurukshetra described in Mahabharata, almost 10 million human beings lost their lives. And recently, in the tsunami, more than 400,000 people were killed. Disasters of such magnitude have hit mankind over the extended period time and again. However, this one event of the Dajjal's appearance has been rated as the gravest situation of all. What possible threat could this one situation pose that made the Messenger of Allah seek refuge from? To get the reason for this, we have first to understand the meaning of the word Dajjal. In true sense, it is not a name, it is the descriptive pronoun for a subject. The word Dajjal denotes a dazzling imposter, something quite attractive to look at, but in reality is ugly inside. The technical advances of the Dajjal, as well as its different forms, as in democracy, monarchy, dictatorship, communism, dazzle the eye and the mind. As a result, the entire world has fallen prey to its charms, chased its rainbow in hope of finding peace and happiness with the implementation of its doctrines. But exactly the opposite is the reality of most areas under the rule of the different isms prescribed by the Dajjal. They are rife with hunger, turmoil, war and bloodshed, injustice and poverty. The oppressed of the world urge for peace. Peace, but wither peace. Instead of it, there is oppression of the weak by the mighty, triumph of wrong over right, injustice on the ruled by the rulers, and so forth. The earth's soil is wet with the blood of the innocent and imbecile. In two world wars alone, this civilization has been responsible for the deaths of over 140 million human beings. Another 20 million have been lost to different wars and skirmishes ever since. Most recently, this civilization has taken the lives of 1 million people. The number of injured and disabled are double of the deceased. The cry for peace has never been louder, yet to no avail. Most statistics reveal that the only development that is taking place is in the field of science and technology. In the moral sense, mankind is most definitely falling at a fast pace. Crimes of all types are rapidly on the rise all over the world. There is not one country where the crime rate is steadily going down. Where will all this end? The consequences of such an unabated downgrade leaves the thinking mind baffled. To top all this is the fearsome threat of the nuclear weapon. The Dajjal's atomic bomb is capable of rendering the earth into pieces in minutes. It is because of these destructive qualities that the Messenger of Allah has termed the Dajjal as a giant. This perilous situation is proof of the Judeo-Christian technological civilization being the deceiving, lying imposter prophesied by the Messenger of Allah so many centuries ago.
This video footage is enough to make us realize how dangerous the situation of the Dajjal actually is. Therefore, to warn his people of the future, about this fearsome entity, the Messenger of Allah left a series of allegorical references describing its appearance and character. It would have been impossible otherwise to make them understand a civilization based on such advanced technology. Is it not ironical that we, the people 1400 years later, also accept the allegorical description to be the actual meaning and await a giant of such proportions? That this giant is not anything else than the Judeo-Christian civilization is what this video will prove, inshallah. Let us study the Messenger of Allah's hadith regarding this one by one.
To help his people understand the speed of the Dajjal, the Messenger of Allah has said, it will be very fast, like the clouds driven by the winds. If the Dajjal were indeed a giant, what would be the need to compare it to the clouds? In fact, it is because it is no giant that it has been compared as the clouds. It will go where it wills, when it wills. When an airplane takes to the skies, it resembles a wind-driven cloud more than anything else. For this reason, the Messenger of Allah used the analogy of a wind-driven cloud to make his Sahabis, his companions, understand the speed with which the Dajjal would travel. For his companions to understand the concept of an airplane flying in the skies was next to impossible. Therefore, he did so through an allegorical reference. Is it still logical to deny that the Judeo-Christian civilization is not the Dajjal described? In another hadith, the Dajjal will travel around the world in as much time as needed to say the Jummah prayers. The typical concept about the Dajjal is that of a huge giant whose mount has one foot in the east and the other in the west. If that were indeed true, it would take just about a minute to move around the world one time. It would most definitely not take 90 to 95 minutes. On the other hand, if we accept the Judeo-Christian civilization as the Dajjal, this becomes true because an artificial satellite placed in orbit around the world takes about 90 to 95 minutes to complete an orbit, more or less the same time as is needed to prepare for Jummah and attend it. The example cited by the Messenger of Allah regarding the Dajjal speed is exactly matched by that of the satellite created by the Judeo-Christian civilization. Is it still justified to reject that the Judeo-Christian civilization is the Dajjal? Let us present another example to clear this. 2 centuries back, when Jules Verne wrote his famous book Around the World in 80 Days, it was the subject of immense speculation as to how it was possible to travel around the world in only 80 days. Yet, in only 100 years, it was a reality, and today it takes less than 80 hours. Can we imagine then what a fantastic idea it would have been to illiterate Arabs of 1400 years ago to hear that it would take only 90 minutes to go around the world once? This allegory was used by the Messenger of Allah to convey the speed and might of the Dajjal to his companions. In one hadith, the Messenger of Allah has said, the Dajjal will bring under its subjugation all the land and waters of the world within its might, strength and influence. Its domination of the world will be as uninterrupted as the skin on an animal's back. What is in total control of the world today? The answer to this is undoubtedly the Judeo-Christian civilization. There is no space on this earth outside the reach and influence of this civilization and where its will cannot be imposed. There again, the Messenger of Allah has used the allegory of the skin on an animal's back to stress on the absolute power and influence of the Dajjal all over the world. This in turn is the mirror image of the Judeo-Christian civilization today. In the history of mankind, no other civilization or culture till now has been able to bring the entire world within its fold save this Judeo-Christian civilization. Note how the prophecies of the Messenger of Allah come true to the letter. Also, it leaves no doubt that it is no giant, rather the Judeo-Christian civilization, which in fact is the Dajjal. To stress on the Dajjal's size, strength and influence, the Messenger of Allah has often described the Dajjal in different manners. For example, in one hadith, he says, the difference between the 2 years of the Dajjal's mount will be 70 hands. In other, he says, the Dajjal's mount will have 1 foot in the east and the other in the west. For those who have taken the allegorical references of a one-eyed giant astride a gigantic mount quite literally, surely these two hadiths are sufficient to correct their interpretation. In the Arabic language, 70 stands for countless or too many to count. Let us imagine a mount or a horse with 70 meaning thousands of feet distance between its 2 ears, which has 1 foot in the east and the other in the west. Is such an animal truly feasible? Where is the space for such an animal to move in this small earth? Interestingly, in the first hadith, the Messenger of Allah has mentioned the ear, that is, the organ of hearing. What is the meaning of this hadith, if not that the Dajjal will in a moment hear what is said on the other side of the world? Its parallel today is the radio and the telephone, inventions again of the Judeo-Christian civilization. It enables the listener to hear from thousands of miles away. Is it still logical to claim that the Dajjal will emerge as a giant on a gigantic horse? In the other hadith, the Messenger of Allah states that the Dajjal's mount will have 1 foot in the east and the other in the west. This again is an allegorical reference to the worldwide application of the scientific technology of the Dajjal. This scientific technology is the Dajjal's mount that will take it to the farthest corner of the world. This has 1 foot in the east and the other in the west. The numerous dazzling inventions of this civilization has enveloped the world like the skin on the back of an animal. This is what the Messenger of Allah tried to make his companions understand through series of allegorical references. To ensure that his Ummah, his people of the future, recognize the Dajjal, the Messenger of Allah has left another series of hadiths which help us to easily identify it. For example, the Messenger has said the Dajjal will be able to hear and see what is happening on the other side of the world. It is easily ascertained that this hadith refers to information technology over the last decades. Information technology has developed so rapidly that this era is referred to as the age of information technology. Also, it does not come to anyone as a surprise that this technology is the invention of the Judeo-Christian civilization. Use of this source, namely internet and television, enables people to hear and see what happens on the other side of the world. A satellite also lets us focus on any particular place on the earth. This widespread use of technology has been allegorically described as the Dajjal's ability to hear and see all over the world. In another hadith, the Messenger of Allah has said that the Dajjal will have huge amounts of wealth from which it will give to whom it wills. Those who oppose it will not be given any share from it. In this way, it will persecute Muslims. Those who accept the Dajjal will dwell in comfort, and those who don't will hardship. Presently, rizq is denoted only by food sustenance. In reality, all worldly possessions are rizq. Undoubtedly, the Judeo-Christian technological civilization is in possession of huge accumulation of wealth. In fact, they control the lion's share of all assets in the world. And who is benefited from it? No one save those who wholeheartedly accept all the norms of its political, economic, in short, collective life. To these people, the Dajjal distributes wealth in abundance as aid and loan. The people of the world, inclusive of all its Muslim population, are dependent on the handout of this civilization. People die of hunger if the Dajjal does not help them with charity. Their governments become inoperable. If any country in the world, especially among the Muslim countries, dare to disobey the West, they are immediately punished with economic and trade embargoes. Example, Iran, Syria. If trade economic embargoes don't work in completely subjugating them, they are faced with military invasion and eventually dominated. Example, Afghanistan and Iraq. To achieve its goal, this civilization has no qualms about killing hundreds of thousands of men, women and children. The old and infirm people are killed by bombs, hundreds of towns, cities destroyed. Numerous Muslims have been hanged. They do not think the inhumane torture of Muslim suspects is violation of human rights or unjust. During this process, they have not even hesitated to rape hundreds of thousands of Muslim women. All these crimes against humanity are not considered inhumane. It is all very neatly labeled as collateral damage. For these reasons, the Messenger of Allah has foretold that the Dajjal will cause great misery to Muslims, and see how accurately his words have come true. After all this proof, is it still logical to await the Dajjal as a huge giant? Another hadith is put forward in this regard. The Messenger of Allah has said that the Dajjal will declare to be the Rabb or sustainer of mankind and force them to accept it as their provider. What would it mean to claim to be the sustainer, Rabb of mankind? It means it will prevail upon man to shun the orders of Allah and instead obey it. The claim of the Judeo-Christian civilization is the same thing. This superpower stresses upon mankind to accept it as its Rabb or sustainer, to obey all its orders. The principle of this system is that the sovereignty of the Maker is outdated, therefore obsolete. So, to become progressive and productive societies, it is imperative to adhere to the Dajjal's system. In the personal level, the Dajjal holds no objection to anyone's religious beliefs. It has no issue with Muslims wearing beards and visiting the mosque 5 times daily. It does not object to the Christian wearing a cross around his neck or visiting the church regularly. A Buddhist clad in saffron robes and sitting in meditation in front of the Buddha's statue does not irk the Dajjal. The Hindu is not barred from wearing sandal and vermilion marks on his forehead and going to the temple to offer his prayers. Nor does the Dajjal object to the Jews wearing the Star of David or going to the synagogue. But none is allowed to disobey the Dajjal in the national collective life. No one is allowed to establish and maintain the collective national issues prescribed by their religions. Here, most definitely, must the Dajjal's word go. The age-old traditions prescribed by religions the world over are obsolete in today's scientific world. So, in the collective national and social lives of people, the word of the Dajjal is the most appropriate one. If the Dajjal is obeyed, in return it fulfills people's needs as sustainer, the Rabb. In a hadith, the Messenger of Allah has stated the Dajjal will be in possession of two situations similar to Jahannam and Jannah. What it calls heaven will actually be hell, and what it calls hell will be in reality heaven. If you are present at the time, try to be put in its hell. That will be heaven for you. We are aware that the Sovereign, the Allah, is He who has the right to the final say on any matter. For this, the Almighty affirms, إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ, meaning, surely the decision rests with Allah only. Yet, the Lord Almighty was officially removed as the final word giver in 1537 with the separation of the church and the state. From that time forward, man became the sole authority to rule on all matters regarding the constitution, economy, penalty, etc. After a long reign of kings and monarchs, the first system that was accepted afterward was named secular democracy, where the decision-making power rested with the majority population. Yet, man has been endowed with limited knowledge in all areas. Therefore, for him to design a flawless system that would ensure peace and prosperity for all is next to impossible. Consequently, when the whole of Europe implemented a greatly flawed system in their collective lives, great disparity of wealth and injustice in all levels of life became all too apparent. As a result, a segment of underprivileged and deprived people rose in revolt against these unfair practices. In another part, a Jewish sociologist by the name of Karl Marx came up with an alternative theory to the existing extremely partial capitalist system. People thronged to grasp this attractive theory of socialism in the hopes of finding peace and happiness.
Russia and China implemented Karl Marx's theory at all levels and soon started propagating to the outside world. What utter bliss it was to dwell under communism. However, they gradually isolated themselves completely from the rest of the world. So nobody had any idea about how heavenly their abode actually was. Communist Russia earned the name of the Iron Curtain, and China became known as the Bamboo Curtain. Within a short span of time, people soon realized that they had actually jumped from the frying pan to the fire and put their concerted efforts into trying to get out of it. Hundreds of thousands of people trickled out from communist parts of Europe into the capitalist regions and from China to other parts of Asia. Even the building of the infamous Berlin Wall could not deter these people from trying to flee. Watchtowers were put up every 50 years, fitted with machine guns. Still people tried to escape. From 1949 to 1961, 2,700,000 people gave up their love of their beloved homeland, family and homes, and escaped from communist Germany. The number of people who died trying to flee was double the number who escaped successfully. Thousands of people risked their lives in hot air balloons, even broke part of the wall with railway engine, and crossed over the wall to freedom. Thousands have drowned trying to cross the channel from China to Hong Kong. There were so many instances of people trying to flee Vietnam in boats of various sizes that a new term, the boat people, was coined to denote them. It does not end there either. After the Korean War, from the 12,760 prisoners of war captured by the North Koreans, only 347 persons refused to return to their homeland. However, from the 75,757 prisoners taken by the Allied forces, 48,841 people refused to be repatriated. These facts force us to think, what manner of heaven is this, whence people give up their life trying to escape, and when taken prisoner, refuse to return to their homeland?
After the phase of socialism came the turn of fascism, or dictatorship in different European countries under the rules of Bismarck, Hitler, Mussolini, and so on. This long process of shifting from one ism to the other, from socialism to communism to fascism, are all nothing but groping in the dark, the net sum of all man-made systems, that is, the Judeo-Christian civilization, the Dajjal. Every nation that has implemented the Dajjal's one way of life or the other has brought on huge damages on themselves sooner or later. The ongoing worldwide recession too has been brought on by the usury-based economic system of the Dajjal and the spending of unimaginable wealth to further their hegemony. Therefore, there is no doubt that the Dajjal's heaven is actually hell for its inhabitants. While what it refers to as hell, that is Islam, how peaceful that scenario was, this video footage will demonstrate. This depiction is of a village market in Medina, sometime after Islam was established there. Note that all the shops are open, yet no one is in there. Everyone is at the mosque to attend prayers. Imagine the situation of peace and security that can enable one to leave even jewelry shops unattended while one goes to prayer. On the other hand, in some Muslim lands ruled by the Dajjal's doctrine, the reality is that people praying the mosques have to place their dirty shoes in front of them in fear of those getting stolen. For these reasons, the Messenger of Allah has often referred to the Dajjal as the Masih al-Kazzab, or the great liar. The Messenger of Allah has said that the Dajjal will be blind in the right eye. All the religions or ways of life that the Almighty revealed through the long list of Nabis and Rasuls have been a well-balanced mix of body and soul, spirit and material, this world and the thereafter. In direct contrast, the system that the Dajjal promoted is completely devoid of all things right, that is, the soul, the hereafter, the supreme truth of the Almighty's existence. Therefore, it is blind in the right eye. All its actions are directed only towards life on earth, on the body and its pleasures, on material and technology, on machine and its applications. The foundation of this civilization is economic enhancement and the enjoyment of this life, because this is all it can perceive through its left eye. Between the right and the left, universally the right is taken to be the good element and the bad to be the left. Powerful telescopes have allowed the Judeo-Christian civilization to see far into space, this huge universe, but because of the blindness in its right eye, it fails to see the Creator's hand in it. The Dajjal can see the apparent cohesion among all things in the universe, realizes that from one atom to the largest matter is governed in an unbreakable ordinance. Yet, for the blindness in the right eye, it is obvious to the one who governs it all. In one hadith, the Messenger of Allah has said, 70,000 of my ummah will follow the Dajjal. He has further said that his people will imitate their predecessors to the extent that if they see them entering a reptile's dwelling, some of my people will also follow them there. When he was asked, will it be the Jews and Christians to be thus followed? He answered, who else? Both these hadiths convey the same meaning. As we speak, almost all Muslim countries of the world have discarded the rulings provided by Allah and accepted the West's doctrine in the manner of government, education, economy, judiciary and penalty. In short, in every aspect of the collective national lives. Allah has declared usury haram, meaning forbidden. Not only that, He and the Rasul have declared war against those in the practice of it. The promulgator of this usury-based economy is the Jewish community. Empowered by the Judeo-Christian sponsored capitalism, usury has spread its tentacles so securely all over the world today that it seems there is no alternative to it. The so-called Muslim population too has welcomed the usury-based economic system with open arms and established this banking system in all of their countries. If the acceptance of this usury-based economy in direct violation of Allah and His Rasul's edict is not imitating the Jews and Christians, then what is it? It is not only the economic system of the West that this Muslim population has so ardently accepted. They are also trying their best to copy the education system, culture, mindset and values of the society where unlawful sexual relations, homosexuality are considered normal behavior. Owing to the incessant cultural aggression, Muslim population is trying their utmost to get used to the immoral lifestyle of this society. To prove their loyalty to their Western masters, rulers of these countries do not even hesitate to drink in public either. The leaders, rulers, and the general population of these Muslim countries have accepted the Dajjal's doctrine that religion, faith, is a matter of personal adherence, not a collective issue. As such, these rulers, some of whom have blackened their foreheads in prostration before the Almighty, do not think twice about persecuting, confining, torturing, and putting to death the small number of people who want to establish Tawheed, the sovereignty of Allah. In fact, they seek the Dajjal's help in eliminating these select groups.
The Messenger of Allah has said that the Dajjal will emerge from the Jewish nation. Jews and munafiqs will follow it. We have chronicled how the Dajjal came into being from within the Jewish nation. That they should follow it is quite natural. But who are these munafiqs that the Messenger of Allah has mentioned? Munafiqs are those who say one thing and do the other. In another hadith, the Messenger of Allah has said that the word kafir will be etched on the forehead of the Dajjal. The mu'mins will be able to see and read it, but one who is not a mu'min won't see it. How is it possible that a one-eyed animal of gigantic proportions will appear in front of people and only mu'mins believers will be able to recognize it? In this age of technology and science, man can isolate a single gene, atom or nuclear. How will they not understand the Dajjal? Common sense tells us that it is not possible. Even more surprising is that mu'mins, believers, even illiterate ones will be able to read and understand the writing on the Dajjal's forehead. On the other hand, even highly educated non-believers will not be able to recognize it. This proves that this is yet another allegorical reference to the cursed giant. As such, it can be concluded that the kafir will not be written quite literally with the letters kaf, fe, and re. Also, the Dajjal will not be any giant either. The next question that arises is, who then are the mu'mins, believers? In the Quran, Allah says, only they are mu'mins who believe in Allah and His Rasul. Afterward, doubt not and strive with their wealth and lives in the way of Allah. These are the sincere. We should bear in mind that to believe in Allah and His Rasul is to believe in the all-encompassing Tawheed, sovereignty of the Lord in every aspect of one's life. That is to disregard the word of any other than Allah and His Rasul. If we draw a parallel between the believers by the Quran and these so-called Muslims of today, we see that there is no similarity, for these people have effectively disregarded all of Allah's direct do's and don'ts at the collective level and accepted the Dajjal's doctrine in their place. They are openly engaged in committing munafiki, hypocrisy with Allah. How can this hypocrite nation be called mu'mins or believers? And because they no longer are mu'mins or believers, they cannot perceive the writing on the Dajjal's forehead. They lay prostrate at its feet, taking it to be their Lord Sustainer. Also, if anyone tries to point out the Dajjal before their eyes, the so-called alim leaders of this faith turned their wrath on him. The truth remains that he who is a true believer in Allah accept no one else's word save his in every aspect of his life will see and realize the true identity of the Dajjal, even though that person be an illiterate common man.
In another hadith, the Messenger of Allah has said, the Dajjal will order clouds to rain and they will obey. One of the inventions of modern science is the spraying of certain chemicals into clouds to make them rain. It is practiced mainly in areas that receive little rainfall. Sometime before the 2008 Olympic Games were to start, meteorologists noticed a group of rain clouds proceeding towards Beijing. In case rain disrupted the games, 6 planes sprayed chemicals into the clouds and caused the rainfall in a town nearby Beijing. This artificial process to cause rainfall is the invention of the Judeo-Christian civilization. And this is proof that the Messenger of Allah meant this civilization when he mentioned the Dajjal. In another hadith, the Messenger of Allah stated that the cows, goat, sheep, buffaloes, etc. of the Dajjal will be big in size and their udders will also be big to produce milk. Different hybrid species of cows, goat, sheep and other domestic animals that the Dajjal breeds are much bigger in size than the ordinary ones. A typical cow gives about 3 to 4 liters of milk, whereas a farm cow produces about 30 to 40 liters of milk daily. For this reason, many farms in our country are also opting for these bred cows. Is there still any doubt remaining that the Judeo-Christian civilization is in fact the Dajjal? The Messenger of Allah has said the Dajjal will order subterranean wealth to surface and they will obey it. In the lifetime of the Messenger of Allah, it was not known that huge amount of beneath the soil or how to bring them to use. But in today's world, minerals from hundreds of feet under the ground are detected and mined. Oil, gas and other minerals are brought to the surface from deep under the sea also. That the wealth will obey the Dajjal means all these assets are at the Dajjal's disposal. It does what it pleases with them, remits these to places it wants, and uses them to fuel its mills and factories, machinery, ships, cars, warplanes, warships, etc. The Messenger of Allah's prophecy has come true to the last word. The lion's share of the earth's mineral wealth too lay in the hands of the Dajjal, and it uses them at its wish, especially against those who are loath to accept it as Lord and Master. Is the Dajjal still any other than the Judeo-Christian civilization?
Dear viewers, during the course of this documentary, we have tried with various logical clips to prove what the Dajjal and its mount actually are. Hopefully by now, you have realized the true form of the Dajjal and that all the references to it have been allegorical. For those who still believe that it will indeed be a huge animal, they can wait till doomsday for the Dajjal of their idea to come true. Another important issue we need to clear is, we are not against the use of scientific technology or its application. For whether a thing is good or bad depends on its use. A weapon that can be used to commit a robbery can also be used to prevent it. It is not the weapon, but how it's put to use that matters. The Judeo-Christian materialistic civilization, that is the Dajjal, has dominated the entire world today, empowered mainly by the huge amount of arms and weapons of mass destruction it has created through the use of scientific technology. On one hand, it has thoroughly rejected the Tawhid, sovereignty of Almighty, and on the other, It uses its power and might to eliminate those who stand for it. The fault for this scenario lies with not the scientific achievements, rather with its wrongful use by the Judeo-Christian civilization. The Messenger of Allah has said, those who resist the cursed Dajjal, their prestige, honor and reward will be similar to the shaheeds or martyrs of Badr and Uhud. The prestige of two shaheeds, imagine the magnitude of the honor. The reward promised to no one from the beginning of the time. That too, the reward of Shahadat at two, not just any battle, but the most decisive ones. The loss at any one of them would have wiped Islam off the face of this earth. To those who returned victorious from Badr, the Messenger of Allah said, do what you will, paradise is yours. What the reward for those who gave up their lives would be, cannot be imagined. After the destruction of the Dajjal at the hands of Isa alayhi salam, the chance of collecting this unparalleled honor will no longer be available. This small window of opportunity is open only for us, the people of the present, to grab. So let us all resist the Dajjal by implementing the sovereignty, Tawheed of Allah, at the national, collective level. May Allah grant you all to understand the reality of the Dajjal and win the prize and prestige of two Shahadats. Ameen.